for all your photo, video, and voiceover needs, check out the fine folks at Blueberry Productions. They will take good care of you. If you don't believe me, you can see for yourself. Check out their work at blueberryproductions.tv, the Facebook page, Blueberry Productions, also a Vimeo page, a YouTube page, and it's Blueberry, B-L-U-B-E-R-R-Y, prod on Twitter. Check them out today. Blueberry Productions, great people, great work, great service.
Hey there, your yard took a real beating this summer. Luckily, Scott's Turf Builder Winter Guard has your back. Just feed your grass with Scott's again this fall when the air is cool and the soil is warm. It's the perfect time to give your lawn a boost. If you do, Winter Guard will give your yard the nourishment it needs to help weak, thin grass recover and support root growth, giving you a greener, more resilient lawn both now and next spring. Guaranteed. Grab a bag of Scott's Turf Builder Winter Guard today. You'll be back to barbecuing in no time. This is a Scott's Yard.
Hey parents, we all try to be extra careful with our children in the car, but then we get an important call or text. Remember, our children are watching. Make every drive a good example. Be in the zone. Turn off your phone. Visit childrenshospital.vanderbilt.org/BITZ to learn more about our Teen Driver Safety Program. Brought to you by Monroe Carroll Jr. Children's Hospital at Vanderbilt, the Ford Motor Company Fund, and the Allstate Foundation.
Hello, my name is Travis Williams, President and CEO of Academics and Athletic Consulting, focusing on educating and empowering tomorrow's collegiate athletic leaders. My passion is for the education and genuine concern and care for today's student athlete. It's the centerpiece of my life's work. A college education, both in and out of the classroom, is a truly rewarding benefit. For more information on AAC, you can go to www.academicsandathleticsconsulting.com. Once again, www.academicsandathleticsconsulting.com. Or you can follow me on Facebook at Academics and Athletic Consulting, or Twitter at Coach TWill24, or Instagram Travis L. Williams 24. Or you can call me at 404-542-607. Once again, AAC is very proud to partner with J.R. McHenry of the Bossman Radio Show, covering sports and entertainment across the country. Please tune in weekly for informative, entertaining, and expert analysis on today's sports and entertainment topics. Thank you.
Killing the Boss Man Show, in front of the show, Coach LaVall Jordan of the Butler Bulldogs here with me. Coach, what's up, man? How you doing, man?
Man, all good this way. Just we're overcoming, managing like everybody else. Doing
Coach,
great.
Let me ask you this, man. You know, it's funny how everything kind of went crazy on my birthday, which is March 11th, with the NBA shutting down. So everything out there just went downhill. So for you guys, how did you all find about the news that the Big Ten tournament, the Big East tournament, is going to be canceled pretty much? And how did you all deal with it, man? Because you have to get kids back home. Got to go school online now. So how was that whole transition process for you guys, man? I know it was hard for us in the NBA, and it'll be hard for you guys as well.
Yeah, it was. It was just, you know, it was almost surreal because you're in the moment. I mean, we were literally about to get on the bus to go over to Madison Square Garden, you know, because it was around noon. There was new games tipping off at noon. And then you start to see the cancellations, you know, Big Ten canceled and Big 12 canceled, you know, so who's left? And so it's like, all right, are we going to cancel too? And everybody else is following, you know, we're going to follow suit. And our noon game actually tipped off, Creighton and St. John's. We were the 2 o'clock game. And so, you know, we're preparing as if it's going to happen. And then around 1 o'clock or so, right before we were about to hop on the bus to head over, you know, it started to seem like, okay, I don't know if we're going to actually play. I think that game got stopped. That game got stopped at halftime. So we had to meet with our team, but they were dressed like in uniform.
Wow.
You know, and I'm dressed. We're kind of about there, ready to go get on the bus. And then we had to break the news to them. So there was a lot of emotion just because, you know, that's, you know, then at that point, it's like, all right, the Big East tournament's, you know, done. There was still hope that we might still play the NCAA tournament, and we had, you know, we'd felt like we were in a good position to get in and the whole deal. But then around, so guys went, it's like, hey, go with your families, grab some lunch. We'll get more information and get back together here when we get more. And around about 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, you know, we had to have another team meeting to tell them, you know, it's all shut down. And then, you know, a lot of emotions poured out because you got seniors that, you know, that's their opportunity is gone, and that's the end of their season. And so everybody was kind of hurting together on just it being over. So, yeah, that was – so you get through that, and now, you know, you got to get on the plane and get out of there. We were in New York, of all places.
Oh, yeah.
In the moment. So we get through that, and, you know, we're trying to get out as quick as possible due to, you know, all the risks. And get back on campus. And then it was spring break for Butler University during that time. So no students were here. And so we let guys go home, and then come to find out, you know, spring break was going to get extended for a long time. So yeah, that was just the communication piece, because it was coming so fast, right? And it's nothing we've ever seen before in our lifetime.
It was funny because, you know, you was in New York. The Hawks played the Knicks on my birthday at night. So I was kind of thinking about, did any of the New York people pass it on to us? Because, no, it's the Knicks. Yeah. They're here. So it was like, you know, I was worried for a few weeks there. But when nothing happened, and I was like, okay, maybe I'll be dodge this bullet right now, because I was scared for it, because I have asthma. So I'm like, okay, let me hope, yeah, hope they didn't give me nothing, but thank God that worked itself out. But yeah, if you was in New York, I'll deal with the Knicks. So it's like we kind of had a similar situation going on at the same time.
Yeah. And there was a moment right after we arrived, you know, they told us all to, you know, just quarantine at home for 14 days, just because we were just coming from that area, and we didn't want to. You just didn't know. We didn't have a lot of information. You know, it was like, okay, so yeah, everybody's been walking around. You know, people on the plane been walking around in New York City, and, you know, getting ready to go to game. Now there's no game, but everybody's been out in public. So, you know, what do we do next, and what does that mean? So, thankfully, you know, there was no positive cases in our party, and everybody was fine from a health standpoint.
Academically wise, I know your academic advisor really played a big role getting your young men to work from home there, because, you know, when you're used to being in class in front of your professor, to have to transfer to the virtual learning, right, snap of a finger, the academic advisor had to really help them out a lot, especially with their blackboards. And, you know, you all can watch it, of course, with blackboard, but having to get those young men to keep their grades up, keep take care of their responsibilities academically while at home to their own devices had to be a little challenging at times. But knowing your staff there probably got young men, those spring semesters real good for those young men for you.
Yeah, I think it was, you know, you had a new level of appreciation for teachers and professors, right? Because my three, I've got three daughters at 12, 7, and 15, 12, and 7. So, you know, we were turned into homeschool teachers and trying to facilitate the online and the remote learning stuff. And for the professors, you know, they were, everybody, you know, faculty and staff, they're all trying to figure out how to, you know, formulate something that would be able to do. So that took some time, you know, for professors to get together, how they could, you know, finish the semester, and then everybody's adapting to that plan. And, you know, for our academic people, advisors in athletics, you know, how to help support. And when normally you got a study hall or a study table, and you got, you know, tutors and resources here, but now everybody's at home and you're doing it all on Zoom like this, and trying to stay engaged. And so, yeah, that was a whole different thing that I think everybody you grew comfortable with after some time. Now some people still have to do it, you know, unfortunately, here in the fall semester. And so we've started that way for the first 2 weeks. And yeah, so, but at least there's a reference, you know, it's like a new level of comfort, even though it's not what you want. But at least you know what you're supposed to be doing. You know how to access things, you know where to go and how to, you know, how to communicate even with, since you're not in person.
Now, Coach, for your young men's bodies, I know some of them probably didn't have hoops at their homes back home. So, drinking distance, Coach had to probably work overtime to find the young men ways to keep themselves kind of semi-quasi in shape without having a hoop and different plans, knowing that based on what they all have at home, because you don't want to get back to you and kind of start from scratch. So, how did that process go for you guys?
Yeah, it is crazy. You're trying to figure out what you can do, right? You know, you want to give guys a basketball workout, but gyms are shut down, you know, especially back in, you know, April, you know, when we would be in our postseason before we release them to go home, May. Guys don't have a gym they can get in. Guys, you know, they start taking park baskets off the rims at the park.
And yes.
Like, there's nowhere to play basketball. You're like, if you're a cross-country runner, you're fine. You just go outside and run and pick your distances. But you needed, you know, weights and things to develop your body. And so, yeah, our strength and conditioning coach, Matt Johnson, was, you know, working overtime to just come up with what we could send them, bands and things that they could use while they were at home. You know, he was posting videos, and we had a team Instagram account where he was, you know, just firing things to demonstrate exercises and show them to come up with some routines. And, because they're just so used, you know, as an athlete, especially a collegiate athlete, you're just so used to the routine.
Most definitely.
Right? You know, getting over, getting in the weight room, get with one of the coaches, get a workout in, you know, class and study hall, and, you know, you're just regimented. And now you get home, and it's like, you know, you didn't have to wake up maybe at the same time and have the routine. And so that was a big challenge, to say the least, just trying to – get a routine for them, give them things that would keep them engaged during that time when we were apart. And then it became, usually we would get our guys here in the summer at the end of June for us. Newcomers come in and other guys, returners are back, and you get those, you know, 8 weeks, 6 to 8 weeks you're allowed there in July, heading into half of August. And so that even got, you know, we were all online for the summer. So guys were still at home, and you're trying to, you know, now you got your newcomers that you want to get here, and, you know, you had an introductory and the team building and team bonding and workouts and get their fundamentals in place. And so now that all of that got delayed as well. And so those young guys that finished up high school that are so eager to come.
Most definitely.
Can't come yet. So that was, you know, all of that was just new challenges. And so many coaches, and you're on the line with other coaches, because nobody has a game plan for it, right? Nobody's got the playbook to say, oh, here's what you do when a pandemic comes.
You don't got that. You don't have that one.
No, it's like you got to have a lot in your tool belt, in your kitty as a coach, but nobody had the playbook for this one.
No, most definitely. And, you know, it's kind of speaking to you in those Zoom meetings you had. You know, we have a lot in our country social unrest with all these different killings. So how did you all address that with the team and try to give your team an education about that and get them all ready to the vote and understand that they do have a voice, they have power, and get them to understand the issues of what was going on around us? Because, you know, we've kind of had the pandemic and the social pandemic as well at the same time coming together. So right here and right in our faces in 2020. So how did you all kind of talk to your team about that, help them all understand what's going on in our country right now?
Yeah, no question. We'll never forget 2020, right? Any of us that were, you know, will live to tell about it. But yeah, I think that was, you know, just being open and honest. You know, we try to have that environment and that culture in any ways, JR, where we can just hop in and have a conversation about real talk. We say all the time, hey, we don't want elephants in the room. Like, we're not going to be, you know, better men, we're not going to be a better team, we're not going to be better players. And we got to have some humility about us to be able to handle the truth. And so but when truth unfolds right in front of you, it's a difficult thing. You know, it's difficult for me, I'm sure it's for you at our age, to process, you know, what was going on, why something like a George Floyd murder would happen in 2020. And, you know, all the elements that resurface that come with that. So for me to process and then try to help our guys process it. You know, they're 18, 20, they've got different ethnic backgrounds, and they're trying to understand. But allowing them the space to talk was kind of the first thing, to just open up talk about the other feeling and just unload and just listen and some of the things that were going through their hearts, their minds, and then keeping the dialogue going and then starting to educate, you know, where, you know, systemic racism and some of the things that go along with it and the history of our country. So we've had some real good Zooms with, you know, good use of it is, you know, sharing videos with them, you know, from an educational standpoint, and then having dialogue about, you know, about things that, you know, that happened in the past, and then talking about change for now. Like all of our guys, proud to say, are registered to vote. We had did a voter education Zoom with someone that to help us out last Thursday to talk about making sure, you know, the toolkit they need for absentee ballots, because most of our roster isn't from Indiana, so they gotta be able to request it on time. And, you know, we have a Be United initiative in our athletic department that started as a result of all of this to just address it, and having them take that vehicle and that platform, and did a crucial conversation. If your listeners hadn't heard it, you know, they can check out butlersports.com, and there's a Be United crucial conversation where a couple of our players and myself allowed them to open up right here in the middle of the court at Hinkle Fieldhouse and just talk about, you know, a lot of the things that they're dealing with in this context. And so it's been awesome to see them kind of want to engage and be involved and want to seek change. And as they understand more ways of how they can do that and go about it through all of this unrest.
And coach, you know, I got to tell my listeners, like, for me, I'm JR, but when I watch out my Atlanta Hawks gear, I'm just JR, a black guy in Atlanta. You know what I'm saying? You're just LaVall, a guy in Indiana, in Indianapolis. So it's like, we should take off our gear. We're two black men and trying to live our lives the right way. And, you know, we could go out, it could be us. It could be hashtag JR, hashtag LaVall, because unfortunately, our country is not progressing much as we thought it has. And I feel like we have to educate our young men and get them that background, because for me, I've decided to use my show as a platform going forward, because I have a voice. I got to use it for good. You know what I'm saying? And now I'm going to do me a 501c4, sort of nonprofit, to help out as well. So I've been inspired by this to use my voice, having Rayshard Brooks right here in my backyard, Mark Arbery right here in my backyard, to do something about this and help our state and help our nation regionally, and let's try to make a difference in some way, because I feel like, coach, it's time for change. We voices like you and I can help spur that change as well, coach.
Yeah, no question. I think, and I've said this multiple times now, you know, some of the things that we've seen is like, once you see it, right, you can't unsee it.
Most definitely.
And now, you know, there's a choice we have to make. It's like, if you feel like that's okay, that's your choice, right? But I would like to think that most don't, right? So now, how do we go about pursuing, you know, what we do want as a culture? Because that's definitely not it. And now what's our role in that? Like, you got a platform. We have a platform as coaches. You know, you've seen athletes, you know, in a big way, professional athletes use their platform, you know, what's our role in it and how to go about, you know, influencing true change, right, to have it be in a better place. And so, you know, again, we're all making those decisions on what we want to be a part of and what vehicles to jump on, and whether it's voting initiatives, whether it's things on our campus in our Indianapolis community that we're going to join in and be a part of. But whatever it is, it's like, hey, this isn't the way we want it. So that's all, you know, and you're right. It's, one of the most impactful things for me, Jared, was one of our, Bryce Golden, one of our players who, you know, who's not black, he's a white kid from Virginia. He called me a few days after to check on me, which was really impactful. It's like, you know, just, hey, coach, how are you doing? Knowing he never experienced it, doesn't necessarily know what it's like to be black, but there's such a care level.
Most definitely.
And we've got obviously a relationship to where he was just calling a check, not as his coach, just as like, you know, somebody that he knows that is, it looks like, you know, that is black, that's could, you know, just knows they're probably different, a whole set of emotions running through just saying, you know, how you doing? It was a big thing. And I think having those crucial, you know, like I said, we had one winning amongst our team, multiple. There's one out there that everybody can go watch. But those crucial conversations, uncomfortable conversations, the dialogue that hopefully is happening in a lot of places. And let's be honest, like, if we're going to be comfortable, we're probably not going to change much. Right. So it has to get a little bit, it has to get uncomfortable here for, and that's the thing about speaking up, using a voice, you know, peaceful protest, like those things aren't, it's not comfortable for a lot of people, but it moves the needle to where we're going to have to do something different.
What I'll say is, Coach, before we move on, my next question is, like, I've lost four sponsors since I've been talking about us and the system, what's been going on. I lost four sponsors. But I say this, Coach, like, you cut me off because it's not the Hawks, Braves, or whatever you want me to talk about, but talking about my people, you cut me off. So it tells me all you know about you as a company. If you're going to cut off your sponsorship because I'm saying stuff that you don't want to hear, what makes you uncomfortable? So it's like, wow, really? You know, talking about real life stuff is an issue for sponsors, I see. So I was like, it took me back, but I'm like, I shouldn't be surprised because everybody's not with the movement, of course. You know, everybody does not want change, but we'd still be about the change. Those who push back against it, we still got to be about it and fight against that and still push the right message to help out the right people. So when one person hears it, tell somebody else we can get something going and get their ball rolling that way, then we will have some change eventually down the road here.
Yeah, no, exactly. It can't be status quo, you know, that's for certain. And you know, it's like the thing I tell our team there about culture is if you have a culture, everybody doesn't fit, right? That's the beautiful part of it now. And it's like, you know, if it fit everybody, well, this culture that we want is like, you are all human. We're all the same under God, you know, created in the image of God. That's what I believe. So it's like, well, that makes us, you know, one. And now
yes, indeed.
Growing toward treating each other as such and putting systemic policy in place that hold people accountable when they don't. And having opportunities be as such. And if you lose a fan or if you lose us, but it's like, hey, you know, that's their choice, but this is not about, this is a human
yes thing. This is right and wrong
this is bigger than that.
Now, Coach, let me ask you, how's recruiting been via Zoom? I know that's been weird for you guys. We have to recruit via Zoom and probably doing like campus tours as virtual via Zoom. So how was that new wrinkle to recruiting being this time around for you?
Yeah, it's different, man, because the recruiting is, it's a relationship building process, right? And so, you know, like you and I, if we met in person, you know, it'd be a lot different conversation, just a different feeling, body language and things.
Yes, indeed. Clear.
Like we got a good vibe and the conversation's good, but man, it'd be good to be down there in Atlanta, you know, it's chicken and waffle spot and chop it up, right? But
yes, indeed.
It's just different. But we've adjusted, and I think kids have adjusted, parents, and, you know, you know the fact that they can't have 2 feet actually on the campus at the current moment, you know, just for themselves to – because there's such a feeling, like when you get to a place and you kind of feel – it feels right. And so you don't get that, you know, no different than, I guess, virtual dating. It's like when you're actually with someone, right, you get a – it just feels right, or it doesn't, and at least you know it, right? And so now you can move on to the next opportunity or option. So, but we've done, you know, our staff has done a great job. You know, we've gotten a couple commitments secured via, you know, the virtual recruiting, and so I guess it's going well. But it is a ton different. I'm a big guy on, you know, when you get here and you kind of get to see the interaction with a kid and his family on a visit, and you get to, you know, you just learn a lot of things that maybe the unsaid things that you get to notice on the character, you know, of a person, and you know, the family values, just by seeing how they function when you get to spend, you know, up to 48 hours together on a visit, or we get to go have contact in their homes or in their schools and kind of see them in their environment, yeah, we just don't get to do those things right now.
Oh, definitely. Because I can say, you know, I was playing for the Final Four, having all you all in town and having you come to the studio and coming for interviews. Man. Yeah, I was back here getting ready to make texts and phone calls. Hey, if you're in it, okay, I get it. If you're not, come by. I had it all mapped out. Have everybody come by the studio for at least 10-minute interview with me, but failed through on me.
We had our guy, Kamar Baldwin from Winder, Georgia, right down there. He was a senior. He was like, he's going to go down as one of the best ever, put the Butler uniform on. He was ready to try to make it to Atlanta. He was ready.
Yes, indeed. And, Coach, another one I got for you, man, non-conference schedule. I know it's been hard for you guys trying to get games done, not knowing if non-conference is going to really go down because of the virus and stuff. So how's it been trying to get games? Because I know a lot of schools haven't released their schedules yet because they don't know who they'll be playing non-conference. You know, even be a non-conference schedule. So how's that been
for you? Yeah, we've got agreements and contracts that that agreed to, you know, earlier, prior to the pandemic, hitting and leaving this uncertainty in front of us. Now it's just a matter of what's the season going to look like and if we're going to be able to follow through with, you know, with those agreements or not. And if not, how do we adjust? And I don't, you know, nobody, we don't have those answers yet either because we're trying to figure out when we'd be actually be able to start the season. You know, I obviously, if everything goes like normal, you're talking November 10th, you know, we're going to tip off and play the first game, but, you know, is that going to be possible? And you get new information every day and, you know, some of the testing options that are coming out now and, you know, how's that going to help or, you know, what's that going to lend us to be able to do in men's basketball? You know, football's got their things that they're trying to figure out and some are going to hop in and go and with the fall sports, you know, in some leagues that are that have been delayed to the spring and things like that. So, you know, for us, the challenge is keeping our guys engaged every day, right? Just what
yes,
can we control we can control today and not focus on the other. That's going to be somebody else's job to medical experts first and foremost to figure out what's safe and what's doable. And then we'll adjust, you know, as they give us information, boss, on when we can do what. You know, I think that's the game, right? It's you know, as I told our guys, like, hey, basketball's a game of adjustments.
That's right.
So now, and it's a life, you know, you learn a lot of life lessons. So so now we're going to have to adjust and just be ready. You know, that one of the things we talk about all the time is, hey, the time to be ready is not the time to get ready. So right now we can get ourselves as ready as possible, whether we got a basketball hoop or not, through the summer to try to train. You know, now whether we can get 10 guys out there at a time or not, maybe we can only do 4 at a time, but, you know, do everything we can to get ready. So when that time comes, you know, we can get out there and have our best version of ourselves on display.
That's one of the guys for you, Coach, is this man. Let's talk about Coach Thompson, man. He has passed away, and you're in the Big East Conference, man. And you play at Georgetown twice a year, and he got Patrick Ewing, one of his players there at Georgetown right now. Let's talk about what Coach Thompson to game of college basketball, what he means to the Big East Conference, what he's meant to you personally as a coach as you've grown into your role.
Yeah, that was, you know, you wake up in the morning and you did not expect that news. Obviously, you know, you had over the weekend, you're talking to Lute Olson and Cliff Robinson and Chadwick Boseman and then, you know, Coach John Thompson, and you're like, man, you know, you just and as a young kid, you know, I'm 5 years old in 84 when Coach Thompson won the national championship, and, you know, 10 years old in 89, I was born in 7 when he walks off the court for Boston College, and, you know, and Allen Iverson, and, you know, you got those legendary players that have come through there. And now sitting here in this seat and having a whole different perspective at 41 years old and thinking about, you know, you didn't really know at the time what you were witnessing in his
most definitely
and what he was doing. Now having, you know, transitioned to this point, it's like, man, the opportunity that I have to sit here as a black head coach in the Big East Conference is because of John Thompson and the opportunities that he fought for so many coaches, for so many players, and minorities, and what he stood for and not being afraid to stand and vocalize. And even if it meant, you know, he had to sacrifice, or take any type of backlash, and he wasn't afraid of it. He wasn't afraid of that responsibility and that obligation. And so just knowing, he's a legend, right? An icon, like somebody that transcended the sport. And you know, he'll be on the Mount Rushmore, should be, you know, on the Mount Rushmore college basketball for more than just winning the national championship and being the first Black head coach to win the national championship, but more than that, which that's a big deal. But obviously for impacting, you know, so many way beyond that. You look up now and the Big East has 5 Black head coaches out of 11 schools, which is more than any other conference in the country. And, you know, just the equality to have those, to fight to have those opportunities, you know, that you wouldn't be here without John Thompson.
Coach, I gotta tell you, man, I watched on FS1 and Fox Sports, man, you have some bad suits, my man. You clean on sideline, man. You clean on sideline, brother. I was like, hey, Coach Jordan, clean as he want to be over there, man, coaching them up, man.
Hey, out of all the things I had to think about on game day, my wife handles that one. I'm thinking about Villanova or Georgetown and all of the opponents. She takes care of that. So my wife Destiny, you know, that's a give her a little love and a shout out because she takes that one off my plate.
Hey, great job, Destiny. You did a great job, man. Hey, you be clean, man. I'll be watching that, man. My man clean on the sideline, boy. He coach these boys up, boy. He doing it clean as he wanna be.
I appreciate it.
Hey, man. Hey, Coach, good to catch up with you, man. And I hope you get to Atlanta real soon, man. I hope I get to travel again as I come up to Indianapolis to see you guys, man. Because I know Coach Ram wanted me to come up there as well, IUPUI. So I'm like, I got to see both of you, man, real soon. But as soon as everything chills out a little bit, I hope to get back on the road and know what the Hawks going to do for us in the NBA. That I can definitely plan to make some trips up there to see you guys, man.
Yeah, for sure, man. We definitely have to do that. I know you got to be enjoying Trey Young down there. He's good. I remember trying to recruit him when I was at Michigan. He's good now.
Hey, Ice Trey the game, baby. We're glad we got him.
Yeah.
Hey, yes, indeed. But, Coach, man, hey, be safe, man. Be easy. Hope to talk to you real soon. Best of luck to you and team, man.
Hey, thanks a lot. Appreciate you having me on.
All right, that's LaVall Jordan on the Boss Man Show.
It's that new way. Future Hendrix. Yeah. That's
hip hop fans, I got a great album for you. The debut album from Family Grind ENT, True Speech and 313 Fresh. We're going to give you 2 discs, 33 songs of pure, genuine hip-hop. Albums available on iTunes, Amazon, Google Play, illstreetrex.com, and streaming live right now on Rhapsody, Beats Music, Spotify, Xbox Music, Slacker Radio, and SoundCloud. Check them out today, True Speech and 313 Fresh, Family Grind ENT. Believe in it, get it.
A gorgeous tan from Suntan City gives you an inner glow that relights the fire when you run into your first crush.
Vicky, who was that?
An old boyfriend.
Lucky you just tanned at Suntan City.
Lucky he's single. We're doing lunch tomorrow.
Won't be single for long then.
During Tour of the City, try all 5 tans, including spray tan, for just $4.99. Restrictions may apply. Click to buy now.
When you're a teen, you finally get to make some of your own decisions. Who are you going to hang out with? What do you want to be? Are you going to glance at that text while driving? Remember, a split second is all it takes for something tragic to happen. Be in the zone. Turn off your phone. Visit childrenshospital.vanderbilt.org/BITZ to learn more about our teen driver safety program. Brought to you by Monroe Carroll Jr. Children's Hospital at Vanderbilt, the Ford Motor Company Fund, and the Allstate Foundation.
It's maybe the night that my dreams might let me know. All the stars are closer. All the stars are closer.
Tell me what you gonna do to me. Confrontation ain't nothing new to me. You could bring a bullet, bring a sword, bring a morgue, but you can't bring the truth to me.
Alexa, play Kendrick Lamar and SZA.
Okay.
Maybe the night that
With Amazon Music, a voice is all you need. Get tens of millions of songs. Download the Amazon Music app today.
Yeah, yeah, it's your man JC, the host with the most, baby, and it goes down each and every Saturday night right here in the city of Memphis. That's right, y'all. It goes down at Clicks Sports Bar Memphis, baby. 3705 Malco Way, Memphis, Tennessee, 38125. Come out and join us, the Three Kings, each and every Saturday night for the livest karaoke in the city. Everybody gets in free till 10 p.m., only $5 after. Great food. We got drink specials. We got all kind of games, man. We got the pool tables popping. Whatever you want, we got you, man. Come on out. Have a good time with us each and every Saturday night. That's Clicks Sports Bar, Memphis.